Namaskaram. We have covered so far four topics: Samudra Manthanam, Geography and Polity, Trade and Wealth of Nations. Now we'll go into the next topic of technology, which is the glue that puts together the explanations for the creation of Wealth of Nations, which adds up to the trade activities and establishes how the resources are used effectively to create wealth for, to be shared across by a large number of people. So we'll go through technology. The foundation for technology is found in the Rig Veda. A very beautiful insight is provided in the Richa of Rig Veda 5.81.1. Yunjate manavuta yunjate dhiyo vipra viprasya bruhato vipasthitaha. The learned people yoke the mind and yoke the thoughts in wisdom's vast inspiration. So wisdom is an inspiration. It's a very vast inspiration. The mind is yoked together in a technological framework with the thought and the process, thought and the material. And they inspire themselves into such an activity where the yoking takes place between the mind, the thought, and wisdom by the learned people, the brilliant artisans, the seafaring merchants, and they create the foundation of technology. This is the Rig Vedic Richa. Look at this. You have to believe me, it is from the British Museum. It has been scientifically dated to 6th millennium before Common Era. Using the last wax casting technique called the Sire Perdue technique, these two small wheels were created of bronze with spokes, spoked wheels. They were called amulets. This system of technology is called Madhuchistam. Madhuchista Vidhanam. Madhuchistam Madhutyakshacha Barhishaha. Yajnavalkya Sutra. Madhuchistena Kechitva Janunyo Mutkataha. Ramayana. It's a very brilliant methodology. Somebody invented the idea that you can even create a metal sculpture using wax. So you create a wax statue made of wax from the tree, Ashwatha tree. You may mold it to a beautiful features of nose, ears, eyes and all that. And on top of that wax statue, apply fine clay from a river bank of Sindhu River, Kaveri River, and allow it to dry. And on top create a hole and pour molten metal, then the wax melts away and it leaves behind a metallic image of what wax sculpture showed. This is called the last wax technique. The same technique was used 8,000 years ago in Mehrgarh to produce these two brilliant technological marvels of last wax casting technique used for creating these two spoked wheels, which are Indo-Script hieroglyphs. Sark, Sarka, wheel, potter's wheel. Harka, copper gold. Eraka, metal infusion. Arkashala, goldsmith workshop. This is the root. And this spoked wheel becomes a very important symbol on the Indo-Script, which becomes part of the Dholavira signboard, which says, I am working in goldsmithy Arkashala. It shows it with a spoked wheel. Here is four spoked wheels that have been found and kept in the British Museum today. These are the earliest last wax casting. They are very small, about 2.2 centimeters in diameter, with spokes from Mehrgarh. Two French scientists have done very detailed analysis on how this technological competence was achieved. What are they showing? Indo-Script hieroglyphs, Ara spokes, Rebus, Ara brass, Erka, Ekke, copper, Arka, copper, crystal, Eraka, name of wheel, Rebus, Eraka, copper, Erka, Ekke, Aka, Arka, copper, crystal, Eraka, molten cast copper, metal infusion. And two of them, two wheels are shown, Dula pair, Dula cast metal, thus cast copper, brass casting using Sire Perdue technique. This is what they are communicating with these two spoked wheels. So they are declaring and proclaiming to the world, I have achieved the competence of rust wax casting for this bronze material, which can produce these sculptures, amulets, seals. And a more stunning archaeological marvel was created in what's called a lead white, 15 kilograms of Shahi Tump, very close to Mohenjo-daro. Lead filling, and on top of it a copper shell is put, and with colored with pictures of Indian Indo-Script hieroglyphs of tiger and goat, antelope, karada, dotted, leopard, leopard, rebus, karada, hard alloy, markor, mindal, meadow, ram, rebus, mendeth, med, iron. It can also be described as a goat, black goat, rebus, milaku, copper. So he is working with the lead and copper, and on top of it he is putting the Indo-Script hieroglyphs to indicate that he has achieved using these resources. The leopard indicates that he is producing a hard alloy. He has produced a hard alloy of lead and copper, and on top of which he is able to write down this inscription in colored painting. The same technique is used for producing the Nataraja, which adorns the CERN Institute in Switzerland, produced from Swami Malai, which is one of the six army camps of Kartikeya Skanda, which is a famous center for producing the Utsava Bera. That is the article taken in a procession during a festival day. This is the Tandava Nrityam of Nataraja. In Swami Malai, famous for Surya Padu technique of Pratima of Panchaloga, Lord Kartikeya is called Yaraka Subramanya. Yaraka means metal infusion. They are working with metal infusion to create these artistic marvels of bronze. And the person you are seeing as a Mohenjo-daro priest, we will demonstrate, has signifiers of Indo-Script hieroglyphs, which makes him a poddar, a potadara, an assayer of metal, and a smelter. Dawad, poddar. Pota is a gold bead. Potadara, dara is a thread. He is wearing two fillets, one on the forehead and another right shoulder. And there is a three trefoil that is shown, three dhatu. Dotted circle we have seen, that signifies dha and vatta. Dhatu vatta, dha vatta, smelter. He is a smelter of three metals. He is a assayer of metals. And he has obviously used very fine razor for cleaning, for shaving his beard and stylizing it. Beautiful statue that was found in Mohenjo-daro. And as we saw, infusion of carbon into metal was done through wheat chaff ring. That's called chashala. Chashala also means the snout of a boar. So on a boar sculpture of Khajuraho, on the snout of the Varaha, the chashala of the Varaha, Saraswati is shown as representative of a knowledge system. And this chashala is put on top of a fiery pillar, an octagonal pillar of the type you have seen in Binjor. And this pillar is set on fire. The wheat chaff goes into flames, the chashala goes into flames and infuses carbon into molten metal to convert iron into steel, create hard metal. Revolution. So the Ashtashri Yupa, the eight-angled component, becomes an important component of the Shivalinga, the Rudra Bhaga, Vishnu Bhaga, Brahma Bhaga. So snout of the Varaha is chashala. Chashala is a wheat chaff ring used for infusing carbon into molten metal. This is mentioned in the Satapatha Brahmana on Vajapaya Somayaga. Atha Goduman Upasprishti. He touches the wheat chaff and says how I am going to write it up, and describes how this enables him to create wealth. So this is represented as a metaphor of a person climbing up to the heavens along the on the pillar. The Skamba Sukta of Dharma Veda describes it in greater detail in metaphorical terms. This is called the Yupa. This Yupa is a proclamation of a performance of a Soma Yaga, Vajapaya Soma Yaga, of creating wealth using these resources of the country. This is from the Satapatha Brahmana. Chashala is mentioned here. The same chashala is the snout of the boar of Varaha. And Varaha becomes a great symbol even in Kiradi on a carnelian ring. And we have seen the beautiful statue of Varaha in Khajuraho. Yupa. 19 Yupa inscriptions have been found because they are proclamations. And together with the Yupas, 19 upas that have been found from Allahabad, Mathura, even East Borneo by Moolavarman. Inscriptions written down. I performed a Somayaga. So conclusively proving that these upas, these octagonal pillars, were signify as proclamations of creating Somayaga, wealth creating activity. What more evidence do you want? Inscription says, I am producing wealth. I am performing a Somayaga. Bahu Suvarnaka. I am producing many wealths, many golds. Bijror, Pinjor, octagonal upa, found in a fire altar. And that fire altar has been identified. It has been deciphered. Because a seal was found together with the fire altar. Konda young bull, Konda Artaner, Konda, fire altar, live coals, Agrikunda. And top of the, in front of the bull is the standard device, Rangado Lake, Sangara proclamation, metallic iron alloy implements, hard alloy workshop. Then the symbol, the seal of Pinjor also had a text, said Aya, Anchu, Aya, fish, Aya, iron, Ayas, alloy metal. Kanda, four, a circumscript, Kanda, metal implements, Kodi, flag, code, workshop, Karanda, duck, Karada, hard alloy, and in the same site, a Zebu bull was found. Pola, Zebu, Bos Indicus, Pola, magnetite, ferrite ore. So they were working with metals, gold, and metal casting. So the stake is a Medha, Medhat, Med. Medha is Yagna Dhanam. Garuda inscription of Besnagar, made by the Greek devotee of Vasudeva, as an inscription venerating Vasudeva. This Garuda column of Vasudeva, the god of gods, was erected here by Heliodorus, the worshipper of Vishnu, son of Dayan, and inhabitant of the Takshashila, who came as a Greek ambassador from the great king Antaklidas to King Kashiputra Bhagavadra, the savior, then reigning prosperously in the 14th year of kingship in Brahmi script. Besnagar pillar. We have the Siena Chiti, Siena, Ahangar, Asan, Thunderbolt, dated to a few centuries before the Common Era at Purola in Uttarkashi, central Himalayas. It's 24 by 18 meters, same proportions 4:3 as the Siena Chiti prescribed in the Shulba Shastras, Shulba Sutras, built on a scale of about 200 times larger. So this earliest Vedic sacrifice has been found in excavations. This is the earliest evidence from Purula, Uttarakhand. The structure is in the shape of a flying eagle Garuda, head facing east with outstretched wings. In the center of the structure is the Chiti, a square chamber which yielded remains of pottery assignable to about 5th century before Common Era. In addition, copper coin of Kuninda, another material of ash, bone pieces, etc., a thin gold leaf impressed with a human figure, tentatively identified as Agni, have also been recovered from the central chamber, which compares with the discoveries in Pinjor of Somayaga, performed approximately 2500 before Common Era in the Saraswati River basin. Three coppers are mentioned in the cuneiform texts. One is called Urud copper, second is called Loha copper colored red, Urud Luha. Urudu copper, Urud Luha, refined copper. Rudra, Shiva, Trayambaka, Ambaka, Ambaka is copper. Trayambak means three coppers. So the three coppers mentioned in cuneiform text find a corresponding representation in the Trayambaka tradition of Bharat. Because the copper, the major producer, major supplier of copper was Bharat from the Khetri mines. We have found Spatikalinga, 1000 years old, from Khmer. We have found octagonal pillars on sculptural fragments from Amaravati. The pillar of Shivalinga signifies the Mahadeva, which is octagonal. Brahma Bhaga is quadrangular, Rudra Bhaga is cylindrical with the Shashala, and Upa is Ketu proclamation, and the octagonal part is called Vishnu Bhaga. Upa is a Ketu, it's a proclamation that the Somasamstha Yaga has been performed. We have seen the Mohenjo-daro brick streets and walls as one of the best preserved bronze age cities of the civilization. Look at the type of metal products that have been produced. Signify the copper bronze technologies. We are talking of technology, right? First evidence of copper in India is from Mehrgarh. A small copper bead dated to 6000 before common era of native copper was found. Beginning of a copper metallurgy was around 4500 before common era in the northwest area. The picture shows a number of bronze tools from Mohenjo-daro. Copper was alloyed with tin, producing bronze. It also had arsenic, nickel, both the elements are in bronze, and lead in varying proportions. This map is from courtesy Archaeological Survey of India. Stoneware bangle metallurgy. So an in situ copper clay fragment was found with the bangle inside the kiln. So bangle was taken out, bangle was laid together into this furnace, stamped with the seal, showing the one horn young bull and the standard device, showing that it is being made by the fire altar workers, fire workers, producing beautiful bangles. The bangles became a symbolic representation, an identity card for the artisan, the metalsmith, the lapidary, who was working with the wealth resource in an industrial dimension on working platforms, circular metal. So this is the detail of how the bangles were assembled together, piled up one on top of another, and put into a large storage kiln, pot as a kiln, and melted and subjected to fire, smelted. So these are the elements of raw material that went from Dholaveira to Harappa, and how the workshops of our industrial scale was created, not only in the Khetri mines, Savar mines of zinc, but also in Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, Chanhu-daro, Kalibangan. Look at the type of material they were working with: Ernstite drills, carnelian, agate. They were able to create tubular drilling with the copper tube and abrasives. Long beads were manufactured, sawn and chipped blanks. Tapered cylindrical drills, constricted cylindrical drills were used. Technological brilliance, working with the type of material that they were, that this equipment could be used. So this is a straight and step drilling with a constructed cylindrical drill of ernstite, setting the foundation for later drilling and using even diamond drills, cutting into diamond. This was achieved in the period 2600 to 1900 before common era. The other materials that were used for even coloring beads, they were adding paints, white paint, to colored carnelian, bleaching surface and etching it and making it in shape. And more examples of bleached carnelian beads. So carnelian was major supplier from Gujarat. From Dholaveira was a major supplier of carnelian beads. We have this beautiful dancing girl produced in the Sirapadiyu lost wax casting technique. She is wearing bangles right up to the shoulder. Kara bangles, car, blacksmith. There is a burials which evidence for wearing bangles. Female burials with bangles indicate changing status of some women over time. Wide and sturdy bangles were created out of shanka, Tarbinala Pairam. Thin and fragile bangles also was created from the same material. So this is how the shell bangle was worked on. Manufacturing process, cutting the shanka and sawing it into small sized bangles of different shapes and sizes. Look at the saw, bronze saw, huge saw, Korat steel saw. Tarbinala Pairam could be cut as the shanka is held between the 2 feet soles, and this broad sword is drawn from the top, hung from ropes, and then the worker draws the saw across to create the cuts into the Tarbinala Pairam shanka shell. And the carpenters are at work in Madras during the historical periods. Complex carved work for temples, temple cars, rathas, carved front doors, veranda columns for houses, musical instruments, agricultural implements were made by these artisans. This working with hematite from Dharwad or Rourkela, Ib, Orissa ends up as an indescript hieroglyph of a Zebu Bos Indicus bull, Pola, bull, Zebu, Pola, magnetite, ferrite ore. On this pot from Nausharo, the bull is shown together with a bird. That bird has been identified as a black drongo, Poladu. Poladu is a black drongo bird. Polad means steel. Poladu, steel. Bulad in Russian means steel. Bulad steel was very famous all over Europe. And that steel, the Damascus steel, came from Bharat. So the Zebu bull plus that black drongo, Poladu, indicates they were working with magnetite ore to create Poladu steel, Bulad steel. What a beautiful representation using hieroglyphs. So look at the way the Indo-Script writing system evolved as a very effective messaging system to communicate to people without any ambiguity that it's coming from the Saraswati Sindhu civilization, the Meluha merchants, the Meluha artisans who are producing iron and steel and other metal alloy artifacts. Hieroglyphs are the most frequent field symbol, the one-horned bull. What does this signify? It's a combination of symbols. One horn is shown and one young bull is shown. That young bull is, the young, one horn is Singi, forward thrusting spiny horned young bull. Singi means a gold ornament, gold. Konda is a young bull. Kondi is a shovel form sack. Kambla, kambla to hold as a sack, pannier on the shoulders of the bull. Konda, which the lady is holding, but also used as a flagstaff. Halka sorghum, a type of corn, proclaiming that the one-horned bull in a marriage procession signifies Kataka, rain ring, Kataka caravan. Konda, konda young bull, konda live coals in a pit, agrikunda, konda sacred fire altar, kodium, wooden circle put around the neck of an animal. So you put around a circle around the neck, you put a pannier and put a one horn and call it Konda Singin. So he is a worker with ornament gold and worker with a fire altar, Konda. So he is signifying very precisely the technologies that he is using to produce the material. And on another seal you will see seven leaves are shown. Low means seven, no means seven. Low means Loha, copper metal. So he is a copper worker. And then one horned bull is shown. It's a Konda, Singin, worker with ornament gold, and inscription also has been read. So this is how the messaging system evolves over a period of time with absolute precision to very precisely describe the bill of material, the technical specifications of the bill of material used in the cargo. Is it clear? The bull also has a heart shape. That heart shape with emanating rays of the sun. Arka, sun's rays, arka, copper and gold. So this so-called heart pendant, a heart symbol that is shown on the body of the young bull, also signifies that he is working with an arkashal, arkashala, goldsmith workshop. He is a lathe worker and he has got a round pota. He is working with a portable furnace, kamata. Kamata means a mint. So he is a mint worker. So a mint as a corporate form has been created in 4th millennium before Common Era, having a caravan of seafaring merchants and artisans of the Tin Bronze Revolution, the Meluha merchants, leading the caravan of seafaring merchants. We'll look at the hieroglyphs are the most frequent field symbol of Indo-Script inscriptions. They define the Meluha artificer, the seafaring merchant, who is engaged in the technology transmission activities. We see the pictures, the field of sorghum, halka sorghum, cholam, jonalu. We see the lady carrying the corn cob, the cob of the halka sorghum. And we see the procession on Atmari, a mosaic plaque, where the central priest is carrying a flagstaff of halka sorghum on the top of it a rein ring topped by the one horned young bull, the unicorn, the famous frequently occurring field symbol of the Indus script corpora. Then we see the pictures of the one horned young bull with extraordinary precision, the prothrombs of two one horned young bulls, a spiny horn, forward thrusting spiny horn on the head of the young bull. There are rings on the neck. There is a pannier and there is a field symbol, a standard device in front of the animal. Each of these is a hieroglyph rendered in Meluha expressions. Sing in, forward thrusting spiny horn, young bull. Singi, ornament gold. Konda, young bull, a bull calf. Kondi, an outspread shovel form sack or pannier, as formed temporarily out of the kambala to hold or fend off grain, chaff, etc. Then the copcorn, konda, holka sorghum, as flagstaff to proclaim the one-horned young bull in a Mari procession. Now, what we have seen here is konda being repeated in hieroglyphs. The scribe, the writer, the accountant wants to make it very clear that he is trying to convey a konda. What is this konda? It is red rebus in Meluha as konda, live coals in a pit, agni kunda, konda, kunda, konda, sacred fire altar. So he is conveying a sacred fire altar and singi, ornament gold, with the singing forward thrusting spiny horn. Then the rein ring on the flagstaff of the holka sorghum cob is kataka, is a rein ring. It also links on a chain shown on the seal. Kataka is rein ring. Rebus, kataka means caravan. A caravan of artisans and merchants of Meluha have arrived in Mari. The rings on the neck are kodium, a similar cognate word, koti neck, a wooden circle put around the neck of an animal in Gujarati. So we are very clearly seeing the depiction of a konda, a live coal pit, konda, a sacred fire altar, kunda, singin, singi, ornament, gold. Then in the body of the young bull, we see a heart sign, heart-shaped sign with sun's rays. And we see very clearly a rear of the horn bull is very prominently displayed. Kar means ear, kara means a wild ass, rebus, kar, blacksmith. Arka, sun's rays, arkashal, goldsmith, workshop. See the gold pendant, heart-shaped, as shown on the belly of the young bull on some inscriptions. Then the device in front of the bull. Kunda, lathe, kunda, fine gold. So singin, ornament gold, kunda, fine gold. So he is a artificer working with both fine gold and ornament gold. Standard device has got two parts. The top part is the lathe, kunda, lathe. Kunda means fine gold. The bottom part is a portable gold furnace, kamata. Rebus reading, kamata mint. Then on top of the bottom part of the standard, dotted circles are shown. Pota, gold bead. Pota, metal infusion. Pota, potaraju. So Kar Kund is an adroit, clever, experienced. He's a manager. Kar Kunda, to work, to labor, to trade. Kar, business, action, affair, work, labor, profession, operation. Pushto language. So he is a trader. He has the profession of making and working with gold, fine gold, ornament gold. Thus the artisan caravan of seafaring merchants and artisans of the Tin Bronze Revolution have landed in Mari in Mesopotamia. He is the director of Ishani corporate firm of the 4th millennium before Common Era. Leads the caravan of seafaring merchants from Meluha. An astonishing representation of the artificers and seafaring merchants' activities of the civilization across long distances. Now take a look at the composite seal showing a number of animals with the centerpiece of a crocodile and a monkey holding on, pointing to the crocodile, looking backwards. Kramara, turn back. Kamar, blacksmith. And we also see the seals of 7 interlocked tigers. Shali is interlocking. Shalika, a village of artisans, seafaring merchants. Salaisu is also a metal joiner. Salai, Kalai. Tin used for tinning vessels, Kalai. Tiger is shown, Kola, tiger. Interlocked tigers are shown, Shali, interlocked tigers. Kamarshala, workshop. Kolimi, forge. Shala, smithy workshop. Shala, interlocked bodies. Shala, smithy workshop. Salaisu, joining of metal. So the 3 interlocked tigers show their feline class prominently. Panja is a feline paw. Rebus, panja, kiln, furnace. Kola again, tiger. Rebus, coal, working in iron, coal hay smelter. So now we are dealing with a group of people who are artificers, working with iron smelting operations, and also working with tin for joining metal, joining of metal, or tin, using for tinning of vessels. The animals shown are also hieroglyphs, which signify metalwork resources, metal resources. The worker is dealing with med, iron, and card, stone. He is an accountant, documenting, as shown by a person with spread legs. Karnaka, spread legs, in Atharva Veda. Karnika, helmsman. Karna, Karanikan. Karanam, Kulakarani, accountant. Kol, tiger. Kolimi, smithy. Kolel, smithy. Kolel, also a temple. Sal is a workshop. Sal, Konda Sal, turner's workshop. So he is working on a lathe, turning material and doing a kundanam, creating gold base and inserting, encasing gems and jewels and jewel precious stones. So this is the message. So the work of the operators, the artificers is very clear. They are working with metals, gems, jewelry, which were the wealthy resources of that time in great demand all over Eurasia. So the composite seal with a number of animals is the Blacksmith Guild of Artisans. The two bulls are butting at each other. Muttika, Muttigai, butting. Mutti, jeweler, jeweler's hammer. Muttika, Mutti, Mushti means a goldsmith. The ox is Bharat Balad ox. Bharata, Rebus, metal alloy. Metal alloy of Bharata is made of 5 copper, 4 zinc, 1 tin. Is it possible that the name Bharata for the nation came from this word Bharata, which is a mixed alloy? Because a large number of people were at work on this metal alloy. Crocodile, Karu, crocodile. Rebus, Karu, artisan. Elephant, Kariba, Iba, elephant. Rebus, Karba, Ib, iron. Rhinoceros, Ganda, rhinoceros. Rebus, Kanda, tools, pots and pans and houseware. Antelope, Ranku, antelope. Rebus, Ranku, tin ore. Monkey, Kutaru, monkey. Rebus, Kutaru, armorer, maker of weapons. The body, med body, meret, med, iron, metal. So now it's very clear. The hieroglyphs on the seals are a very precise bill of lading, technical specifications of the metal resources and gem resources being used for transport across the ocean and maritime riverine waterways. They were water managers, excavated by the Barappa Archaeology Research Project in 1993. Is this large carbonate drain built in the middle of an abandoned gateway at Harappa to dispose of rainwater and sewerage. Look at the technology achieved in architecture. They are able to make a substructure of a causeway for draining out water. This comes out of, a similar rain comes out of the so-called Great Bath, the Pushkarini of Mohenjo-daro. Now look at the workers' platforms. Each of these circular platforms would have been mounted with some kind of a circular hut for the smithy forge workshop to operate, paved brick pavements. I suggest that this constitutes a fada, metals manufactory of an industrial scale, consisting of workers' platforms at Harappa. We have seen that sign of the heart So this shows the evolution of the artisan's skills. He was working with arka, copper and gold. He had a workshop, arkashala, and he shows a pot overflowing water. Lo is pot, khanda is water, lokhanda. Lokhanda means metal ware. Pots and pans are metal. So with one symbol constructed as a hypertext showing a pot and a overflowing water, the scribe, the accountant is clearly conveying that the work is on with the metalwork artifacts, equipment, tools, potware, houseware, metalware. And this overflowing pot becomes a very important recurring symbol on a large number of cylinder seals in ancient Mesopotamia, clearly indicating the impact of the technology of the Saraswati Sindhu civilization on these Velu artisans in the ancient Near East. It's a stunning, stunning gold spectral. Possibly this was encased in a very gold amulet and worn as an ornament by the artisan. So the belly shows the heart-shaped arkashala, pannier is shown, and the standard object is shown in front of the spiny horn, young bull with a prominent ear. Kar, ear. Kara, kar, kar, blacksmith. Look at another seal with an incredible narrative of seven ladies at the bottom, a worshipper worshipping a person in an arch with a pigtail and a horn and a ficus leaf adorning him, arms with wristlets, and the arbor is made of ficus leaves, and accompanying the adorant is a remarkable hypertext animal, a markhor with a human face and a couple of two or three symbols on top. Every one of them is an Indo-Inuit hieroglyph. Let us go through one by one. Bata, worshipper. Bata, furnace. Bata, iron. He's making an offering. Saman, making an offering. Samanon, gold. Markhor is Mindal. Markhor in Thorwali language. Medo, ram. Rebus, medet, med, iron. In Munda, ho, Santali. He's working with Eraka, molten metal, copper. Then the branch of the tree. Manda, branch, twig. Manda is a warehouse, rebus, workshop. In Konkani language, the kneeling position is Mandi. Rebus, Mada, shrine, Mandil, temple. The man wearing a scarf, Dhatu, scarf, Rebus, Dhatu, mineral ore. The rice plant adorning the curved horn of the person. Is she a woman? We don't know. With the pigtail is Kolmo, red Rebus. Kolmo means a rice plant. Rebus, Kolme, smithy. Smithy of what? Kol, Panchaloha. The curving horn is Kodu, horn. Rebus, Kod, artisan's workshop in Kuvi language. The face of the composite animal, Markhor, Muh, face. Rebus, Muh, ingot. And the hieroglyph is combined with Mindal, Markhor in Thorwali, Rebus. It's also Medo in a ram and a sheep in Gujarati. And the Rebus reading is Mendeth, Med, Iron. Santali, Munda, whole languages. What do the Pleiades represent? Bagala, Pleiades. Bagala, a dhow, a seafaring vessel, a catamaran. Look at the total quantity of information given by this seafaring merchant and artisan. Enormous amount of detail is recorded with this brilliant construction of the hieroglyphic writing, pictorial writing of the Indus-Crypt artisan and Karanam, accountant. Scribe, Karnika, Karani, supercargo, managing the seafaring vessel with its shipment. He is responsible for the cargo. Look at another tablet, two-sided tablet. Same text inscription is shown with three signs. There is a drummer holding a long drum and a tiger looking at him with his open mouth. Okara, open mouth. Bokara, bogar, blacksmith. The two wristlets are khara. Plural, car, blacksmith. The wristlets are shown in a bun ingot shape, which signifies muh, ingot. There are five swastikas shown. What does the word five represent? Tattal, tattu. A slang term for five. Rebus, tattar. Gold or silversmith. Tattan. Tattakara, brass worker. In a number of Indian languages, including Tamil. The drummer is Mandari, Munda, Toda village or assembly. Mandir, temple. So he is signifying a temple here. The smithy is kolel. Forge is kolel. It also means kolel, temple, kovil. Kola, tiger. Kol, working in iron, is a blacksmith. Kolhe, smelter. Sattva, as we have seen before, is a swastika symbol. Sattva means jasta, sattva, zinc, pewter. So the identical tablet containing the same type of information on the text messages is clearly a demonstration of the ability to work with zinc and produce brass. So alloying copper with zinc produces brass. Another imagery appears in Bactria Margiana archaeological complex in a place called Giraft and Tepeaca, where a leopard, scorpion, zebu, boss indicus, indescript hieroglyphs are shown to signify the wealth producing metalwork. Ola, zebu, boss indicus. Ola, magnetite, ferrite ore. Bicha, scorpion. Bicha, hematite ore. And we have seen that leopard. Karada is a leopard. Karada means a hard alloy metal. So here is an artisan working with iron and hard alloy metal. And we have got another seal which shows two soles of feet from Tapayahya. And so another side, this other side of the tablet shows a lizard with six legs. They are all hieroglyphs of Indus-script. Adi, foot, footprint. Ade, ade. The piece of wood on which the five artisans put the articles which they happen to operate upon. Lizard is Arane. Arani is an anvil. Ahiran, Ahiran. Aranai, typical lizard. Arana is a greenhouse lizard. The rapist reading is Arana Smithi. The six legs, Bata means six. Rebus reading is Bata, kiln. Bata, a kind of iron. So, it's an iron furnace. So, the anvil is recorded. A smithy and a forge is recorded. And they're working with material of metalwork resources and a furnace are emphatically depicted in these two sides of the tablet from Tepeyahya. A vessel. Excavations at Tali Iblis revealed many objects of copper casts using last wax technique dating from 4th millennium before Common Era. The technique of last wax casting requires treatment at very high melting temperature and control to degree that it could not be controlled until the late 19th century. Can we believe that in 4th or 3rd millennium BCE they were able to achieve this level of sophistication in metallurgy? Fish is shown on this vessel. Ayo fish. Rebus aya iron, ayas alloy metal. Here is an equipment, ritual face, and a wallet-like object showing two snakes, two hoods of snakes point facing each other. Fada, cobra hood. Fada is a Bharatiya arsenal of metal weapons. This is from Shahi Tump, a site in the valley of Kechi crossing Makran in southern Pakistan. It was found dating from 4th millennium before Common Era. A white filled copper lead weighing 13.5 kilograms wide, with hanging loop at the top, decorated mosaics of shells representing a leopard pursuing a gazelle. This proves the mastery of technology in most last waxing casting and that of lead, in addition to the artist's skill at the mosaic. Excavations also are said to be by the locals who were engaged at the 4th millennium BC, before Common Era. A sophisticated and developed agriculture and livestock of wheat and cultivation of wheat and barley in six rows. The level of sophistication that was achieved in technometallurgical brilliance in working with Siro Purdue or last wax casting technique of the 4th millennium is simply astonishing. Here is a square seal. It's a clearly an Indus-script seal from Tepeyahya. The seal impression. cited by Lambert Karlowski, the archaeologist. It shows an upraised hand of a man, Ereka upraised hand, Rebus, Ereka molten cast metal infusion. The man is standing, med body, womb, merhet med iron, med copper, metal in Slavic languages. So the splinter is Sal, Rebus Sal workshop. So he is a iron workshop worker dealing with molten cast metal infusion of copper. Okay, another vessel base showing a Fada, cobra hood, Fada, Bharatiya arsenal of metal weapons from Tepe Yahya and Konar Sandal. There are sites today in Balochistan and Iran, in Kerman province, very close to Mohenjo-Daro. Here is a narrative on a valet chlorite symbolizing artifact with two lions attacking a bull, R.A. lion, Ara, brass. It will also signify Simha, Singa Chivannam, very fine superior gold. Pola, we have seen, is Zebu, Basanticus. Pola is magnetite, ferrite ore. Then also an eagle in flight, Siena, Aseni, Thunderbolt, Ahangar, blacksmith, both in Pashto and Kashmiri languages. So the lead white which you see is the remarkable Serapadu artifact which has been described and which has got a number of indescript hieroglyphs on chlorite vessels, Kola woman, Rebus coal working in iron, coal hay smelter, Pola Basindicus, Rezebu, Rebus, Pola magnetite, iron ore, then moon, Kamar blacksmith, Arka sun, Arka copper, Arka gold, Ereka copper, Dangar mountain range, Dangar blacksmith, Bicha scorpion, Bicha stone ore, hematite, med dance step, med iron, a leopard is Karad Bag, Karada. Karada means a hard alloy. So a number of variant pronunciations are there, expressions are there. Karad Nis, scholar a bad writer, Karad Nisi, Karad a rude sketch, Karadya the writer. So he's a writer and is also working with hard alloy. Markor, Mindal, Markor, Rebus, Meadow, Ram, Sheep. Then again, swastika appears together with a twisted card, an endless knot, and a rosary axe head or knife of copper also shows the similar simple number of an endless knot. What does it signify? Medha is a twist or a tangle in a thread. Medha, twisted, med, iron, medha, yagna, medha, dhanam, wealth. The zinc is sattva, rebus, sattva, jastha, zinc. So we can see symbols being developed. Here is the representation of an ant, a black ant, Chima. Chimakara, Chimara is a coppersmith. Chimara is copper, Chimakara is coppersmith. It's a loha, metalsmith. Chimakara, blacksmith, lohar. Look at the picture of the black ant again on the Mohenjo-Daro seal as a text message. Together with a slanted line and a notch, dhal, slanted stroke, dhalako ingot. A notch is a khanda and khanda is equipment. So he is working with both ingots and equipment. A four and three strokes, four khanda, equipment. Three strokes, three, kolmo, rebus, kolimi, smithi, forge. Kolu, sprout, kolu, bar of metal. So these metal articles that are being worked on by the Chimakara, the blacksmith, coppersmith, is clearly demonstrated. On top of the Zebu Basindicus bull, which signifies magnetite ferrite ore. Another seal with a text sign showing an arrow, a fish, and a fish with a stroke. Io fish, Io iron, IS alloy metal, a sloping stroke, dhalium, rebus, dhalako, large metal ingot. Dhalaki, metal heated and poured into a mold, a solid piece of metal, an ingot. So alloy, metal, ingot. That arrow, khanda. Khanda, equipment. So ingot and equipment. So we will continue with this as we proceed to understand the remarkable idea, the technology of writing systems. One of the hieroglyphs is the bird. It is a bird which has a tail wing forked. It is a remarkable bird which is seen on the fields where the zebu bull roams. And it is called the friend of the zebu bull. It's called Polado, Polygado, which protects the zebu, the humped bull, Bos indicus, from insects. It's a very fighting bird, like an eagle. It's called a black drango. It's very frequently seen in Rajasthan state, northern India. Black drango is Polado, Rebus, Polad, steel. In Telugu, it's called Pasula Polygado and Polado, perched on the pola. Pola is zebu, Bos indicus, Rebus pola, magnetite ore. So, perched on the zebu's hump can be seen on this image. And we can see the variants of the bird hieroglyph on Indus-Crypt Corpora. Winged bird, Polado, black drango, Kamba is the wing, Rebus, Kamata is a mint, coiner. So, steel worker and a coiner. Polado, Polad is steel. Black drango, Polado, Polad, Polada, Poladi means of steel. Bulad, steel, flint and steel for making fire in Amharic. Fulad in Arabic. The Prakritam glass, Pola, Zebu is red rebus as Pola, magnetite, ferrite ore, ferric oxide. Polia, citizen, gatekeeper, the town quarter. Thus the black drango perched on the zebu, Bos indicus, is a hypertext which signifies magnetite, ferrite ore, and steel, hard iron. We'll see later as to how this steel is made by infusion of an element called carbon. So it's also referred to as an eagle, Polado, Polygado, Dodola Polado, an eagle, a black drango, Dicrurus ater is the Latin name. The Bolad, Pulad, Polad, alternately spelled as Pulad, Pulat, Polat, Polad. Even Poland names comes from this. It's Persian and Turkic languages. It's common even given name among the Inner Asian people. The meaning of the word Bolad is steel. Because this was famous. The steel coming from India has achieved the pinnacle of archaeological brilliance in creating a very hard metallic ore material, metal, which had led to a total revolution. The Bronze Age had transited into the Iron Age. Bronze Age had transited into the Steel Age, which could dramatically make very powerful architectural structures and also very hard, sharp swords called the Damascus swords, which are Ukku swords from Bharat. So this steel technology is so famous that Alexander comes to India looking for this gold, wealth of gold of steel. Here is a seal from Rahman Dari, pendant seal, two-sided inscriptions showing two scorpions and a frog and a T sign. On the reverse, it shows two antelopes with winding long horns. Every one of them is a hieroglyph which has been read rebus in Meluha. Tul Bicha, cast hematite for right ore. Sacha is a mould. T is a mould. It's a stone mould matrix. Muka is a frog. Muha is a gold. Is ingot. Muha, the quantity of iron produced at one time in a native smelting furnace of the coals. The obverse two markers are Mindal Markor, Rebus Medet, Med Iron, Med Copper in Slavic languages. Thus, this tablet represents that copper and iron ingots are accounted for in the Rahman Dari inscription. The ore is Bicha, scorpion, Bicha, hematite ore. Vrischika, Bicha, scorpion. Vichika, scorpion. Vrischika, scorpion. Rebus, Bicha, hematite, ferrite ore. Bicha, stone ore, in Munda and Santali. Let's continue. Muka, frog. Muka, Muha. book ingot. I do not know whether it's buried as a mould or a kando stool. If it's a kando, it's kand, fire altar in Santali. The pinnacle of achievement in working with iron and steel, particularly iron, is exemplified by the Delhi Iron Pillar, which is now in the Qutub Minar complex. It was originally in Besnagar, Vidisha. It was moved here. It weighs about 6 tons. It's a manufacturing marvel made by horizontal forge welding. A thin layer of a compound of iron, phosphorus and oxygen makes it rust resistant. Even today, after thousands of years, it has not rusted. It's a rustless iron pillar in the Qutub Minar, Delhi, a major tourist attraction. And brilliant metallurgical work, archaeometallurgical work, was done by the late R. Balasubramaniam of IIT Kanpur. Iron pillars. The broken, rust-resistant iron pillars are seen at Dhar, Madhya Pradesh, dated to 13th century. They are about 15 meters long. They are in front of the Saraswati school set up by Bhojaraja in Dhar. Saraswati in front of Saraswati Mandiram. Rust-free iron pillar is also seen on Kodasadri Hill at Kollur, Karnataka, about 30 meter high iron pillar. Nearby is a small temple. Working with steel and iron, cannon has been made. Rust-resistant iron has been used for this cannon, found in Tanjavur district, Tamil Nadu. Iron working in the Ganga basin has been dated to about 1800 before Common Era. Rakesh Sinha has demonstrated a number of sites, Rajanal Kitila in district Sonbhadra, Malhar in the district Chandavali, and Lohardeva. So the coterminous with Saraswati civilization, an iron ore civilization, iron age civilization, was very clearly visible in the, around the same time in the Ganga basin. So I think the chronology of the Bronze Age and Iron Age got to be rethought, because iron articles have been found even during the Saraswati Sindhu civilization days. So there was a overlap of the Bronze and Iron Ages, thanks to the working with iron and steel, evidenced in the Indus-Crypt corpora. So the Saraswati Sindhu civilization area extends into the Ganga Yamuna Dob, and we'll see it also will go beyond Ganga Yamuna into Brahmaputra, Salween, Iravadi and Mekong in the ancient Far East. So these are the details of the sites close to the so-called upper hoard culture of Atlanjikara, Tadupur, Jusi, Malhar, Lohardeva, Rajanal Kitila and the Ganga River Basin. This shows that we have got to rethink our thoughts about the Iron Age and the Bronze Age. And in a brilliant article, Gregory Possel and Gullampally Praveena have demonstrated presence of iron in the Saraswati Sindhu civilization. So we will see the impact on the of these great finds in the economy of the country and the economy in the wealth of nations in the neighborhood. Namaskar.